Hi, let's talk about the subclavian artery. In this video, I'll describe to you how we distinguish the three parts of the subclavian artery from one another, the major branches from each part of the subclavian artery and what they supply, and then finally, I'll show you where the subclavian artery turns into the axillary artery. So let's begin here by looking at this right root of the neck image. This is an anterior view of the right root of the neck. The subclavian vein has been cut away there, so normally this would have continued on here, but this allows us to see the inferior attachment site for the anterior scalene muscle. The anterior scalene muscle is an excellent reference point for the root of the neck, especially with respect to the subclavian artery. So here we can see the subclavian artery. This is a right subclavian artery, so it originates from the brachiocephalic trunk. And everything from this bifurcation all the way up to the medial border of the anterior scalene muscle is the first part of the subclavian artery. Everything behind the anterior scalene muscle is the second part. And everything lateral to the anterior scalene muscle is the third part. And that goes right up to the lateral edge of the first rib. After the lateral edge of the first rib, it's no longer the subclavian artery, it is the axillary artery. And that axillary artery will traverse the axilla, and then beyond the inferior border of teres major, it will become the brachial artery. So let's take a look at the branches of the parts of the subclavian artery. So again, to remind you, there's the beginning of the first part, and there is the boundary between the first and the second part. And we have three branches. There's the vertebral branch, which is a large branch heading superiorly. There's the internal thoracic, which is a large branch heading inferiorly. And then there's the thyrocervical trunk. So let's take these one at a time. The vertebral artery branches from the first part of the subclavian artery, and then it heads superiorly and medially. Typically, it's going to take a medial turn between the 7th and the 6th cervical vertebrae, and then it will enter the intervertebral foramina of C6 through C1, before then entering into the foramen magnum of the skull. Along the way, it will send branches to the spinal cord. It will also serve some of the deep neck muscles along the way. And once it enters into the foramen magnum, it will meet up with its counterpart, the vertebral artery from the other side, to form the basilar artery. So vertebral artery plus vertebral artery equals basilar artery. The basilar artery serves the brain stem and posterior aspects of the brain, and typically anastomoses with branches from the internal carotid, which is coming from the anterior brain, which we'll see. The next branch is the internal thoracic artery. The internal thoracic artery is going to weave itself down through the innermost intercostal muscles alongside of the sternum as it descends the thorax. It will send branches out to serve the anterior body wall, so the intercostal spaces, those spaces between the ribs, as well as aspects of the mediastinum, and then down to the diaphragm and some portions of the anterior lateral abdominal wall as well, which is neat. And then we have this thyrocervical trunk, but let's address that on the next slide where we have a little bit of real estate. So let's think about this name, thyrocervical. Thyroid, cervical, neck, trunk. So it is a trunk that is going to serve various elements of the neck, and you don't get this from its name, shoulder as well. So let's take a look and see what we can see. So here is that trunk, and there are four basic branches here. There is the inferior thyroid artery. That inferior thyroid artery is going to ascend superiorly and medially to serve the thyroid gland, which we can see here. It's also the dominant blood flow to the parathyroid glands. And it will even serve the larynx via an inferior laryngeal artery, but we can't see that branching point. The next and most adjacent branching point is the ascending cervical artery. The ascending cervical artery is going to serve deep neck muscles, such as the scalene muscles, etc. And then we have the rather large transverse cervical artery. The transverse cervical artery is heading over to serve the trapezius muscle with blood. Sometimes this transverse cervical artery, about one out of every three cases, it will supply the dorsal scapula artery, which is typically a third part of the subclavian branch. We can see right there. And then finally, from the thyrocervical trunk, going across and then back, is going to be the suprascapular artery. Suprascapular artery heads over the superior border of the scapula by the suprascapular notch, and it's going to supply two of the rotator cuff muscles with blood. These are the supraspinatus and infraspinatus, which are located on the posterior aspect of the scapula. One is above the spine, the other is below the spine. And there are also typical collateral connections between the suprascapular artery and other scapular arteries. This image has that very important landmark, the anterior scalene reflected, and we can see this beauty here. This is the costocervical trunk, costal rib, cervical neck, and there are two branches to this. There's the deep cervical artery. The deep cervical artery, not pictured here, serves the deep neck muscles. And then there is another branch that is winding down, but not visible here, called the highest intercostal, sometimes called the supreme intercostal artery, that gives rise to anterior first and second intercostal arteries to serve the spaces between the first and second and third ribs. Moving right along, that anterior scalene has been laid down again, and we have our third part of the subclavian artery and its only branch, which is the dorsal scapular artery. That dorsal scapular artery runs alongside the medial aspect of the scapula, or the shoulder blade, and it's going to serve three muscles with blood: the levator scapulae, which is an elevator of the scapula, as well as rhomboid minor and major muscles. A third of the time, this is going to be a branch of the transverse cervical artery. But two-thirds of the time, it's from this third part of the subclavian. And then finally, we can see there's our rib one. There's our lateral border of rib one. Beyond this boundary, we have the axillary artery. That axillary artery supplies the axilla and shoulder with blood, and it's an important reference point for various divisions and cords of the brachial plexus. So the anterior divisions are anterior to the axillary artery. The posterior divisions of the brachial plexus are posterior to it. Posterior cord is posterior to the axillary artery, and medial and lateral cords of the brachial plexus are medially and laterally respectively located with respect to the axillary artery. So that's an interesting naming convention, which leads us to our terminal assessment question for the video, and that is, which muscle can be found sandwiched between the subclavian vein and subclavian artery? Is it the anterior scalene artery? Oh, I remember the anterior scalene artery is a very important muscle with respect to the subclavian artery. So we know that it's bordering the subclavian artery. We know that the first part is medial to the subclavian, to the anterior scalene muscle. The second part of the subclavian artery is behind the anterior scalene muscle. So that's looking really good to us as an answer. If the anterior scalene muscle is behind the if the subclavian artery is behind the anterior scalene muscle, if we recall, that anterior scalene muscle attaches to the scalene tubercle of rib 1. So we have our lovely anterior scalene muscle coming down, attaching to that tubercle of the rib. Right, there's our rib 1 going across, usually cut off. Behind that is our subclavian artery. And in front of that is our subclavian vein, SCA, SCV. So that's looking like a great answer. Middle scalene is also attaching to rib 1, but it is behind the subclavian artery. That's not a good answer. Posterior scalene, that's with the middle scalene behind the artery. Sternocleidomastoid, no, that's way over here on the neck. And trapezius, no, that's way back there on the back. So anterior scalene muscle, final answer for the muscle that is betwixt the subclavian vein, which is anterior to the muscle, and subclavian artery, which is posterior to the muscle. Thank you very much for your time.